Praise the Lord. Let the church say amen. I said, let the church say amen again. He is the lifter of my head. And he's been doing it a long time. And he's been doing it long before you were born. He's been doing it for your parents and your forefathers. And there's a song, Lord Jesus. There's a song that they used to sing that carried a whole race of people, that lifted the heads of a whole race of people. And I'm going to sing a little bit of it, and I want you to sing with me too. Listen to the message in the song. Praise his holy name. What an awesome God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his holy name. You can give me some verb if you got it, brother. Thank you, Lord. Deep in my heart, I do believe someday we'll all be free. We will be free. I may not know how long 'twill be. Someday we'll all be free. We will be free. Someday we'll all be free. Hold on, my brother. Give me your hand. Someday we'll all be free. We will be free. Learning to love, we'll find our way. Someday we'll all be free. We will be free. Someday. Shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in in my heart, I do believe someday we'll all be free. Someday we'll all be free, and we shall overcome Jesus. Thank you, God, for your Spirit's presence. Will you pray with me, Father, as we open your holy word? I ask, oh God, that you would cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Fill my life with your Holy Spirit's presence and power. Speak to me, through me, and for me, Lord. I promise you I'll always give you the honor, the glory, and the praise. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. My wife Linda is with me today, and I'm so glad that we can be here at Southwest Region Camp Meeting. I live with a woman I'm in awe of. She's one of the most beautiful spiritual people I know. We were going through TSA not long ago, and the TSA agent said to my wife, "Excuse me, ma'am, do you have something sharp in your luggage?" She said, I don't think so. He said, "Please come with me." He pulled it to the side. He opened up her luggage. The first thing that came out was a Bible. She said, "Oh, yes, the Lord did say his word is sharper than a two-edged sword." And it is an honor to see my friend Judge Mathis and his wife. Praise God for you both. Now, I believe God gave to Elder Byrd the theme for this encampment. I believe it. Relevance, mission, mindset, and ministry. And I must tell you, he has no idea how those four words spoke to me. I know they embody the hopes of his presidency, but Elder Byrd, I must tell you, when I read your theme, I embraced those words as marching orders for my message today. And so I just ask that you would pray that God will use me to speak a word to your people here in this conference, and through the technologies at our disposal, speak a word for God's church beyond these walls. Now I'm 12 years away from 80. And I'm well aware that after 50 years of preaching, I have far fewer sermons to preach than I have already preached. So if this one is no nonsense, direct, please forgive me. If I sound radical and revolutionary, if I tell it like it is, please forgive me. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Come with me to the borders of the promised land. The children of Israel were camped at Kadesh with Canaan in view. Canaan was the land of their pledge and promise, the land of their dreams and destiny. Canaan was the geographic promise of the glorious future God had prepared for them. The Lord said to Moses, "Send out for yourself 12 men that they may spy out the land of Canaan. 12 preachers, 12 conference officials, and there they will catch a glimpse of the future I have prepared for them. When they return from spying out the land, they are to report to the people. They are to confirm and convey to God's people the abundant rewards I, the Lord, have prepared for them." The Bible tells us the spies returned after 40 days, their covert action complete, their reconnaissance mission a success. The people rushed out to greet them and marveled at the blessings they had uncovered: scrumptious figs and tasty pomegranates, mouth-watering grapes so large it took 2 men to carry their clusters about. Those 12 spies said to the children of Israel, "Truly this is a land that floweth with milk and honey. And what we have before us is just the first fruit of what God has prepared for us." And then the Bible tells us before long, 10 of those 12 spies began to paint over the glowing report of what they had seen in Canaan with broad strokes of caution, broad strokes of unnecessary pessimism. And without support or urging from the Lord, those 10 spies said to the people, "Before you get too excited about our report, before you revel in our positive and hopeful word, we feel it our duty to tell you that in this land we go to inherit, we saw giants, powerful and fierce. We saw giants, strong and cruel. Before you revel in our brave and hopeful word, we want you to know that we saw giants standing between us and the promised land. They looked mean and ruthless, heartless and brutal, and standing next to their warriors, we felt like grasshoppers before them. They were so huge, and by our informed analysis, we believe we must tell you that we are not able to go up against these people into the land God has promised to us. We feel compelled to tell you, no matter how large our army or how well we fight, we will lose against these people. No matter how we organize and strategize, we're no match for these people, and they will defeat us." Those 10 spies became a pathetic chorus of naysayers, skeptics and cynics. Not only were they overcome by their own doubts and uncertainty, they discouraged a whole nation. Woo. They literally talked themselves out of the blessing God had prepared for them. They talked themselves out of the future God had prepared for them. Oh, but suddenly above that crowd could be heard a lone dissenting voice, a voice clear and strong. It was the voice of Caleb. "Wait a minute," said Caleb. I saw the giants too. But the giants didn't scare me. I saw their height. I saw their muscle mass. But that didn't faze me. Besides, said Caleb, God only asked us for a report. He didn't ask us for our opinion on his ability. He didn't ask us to pontificate on his sovereignty or his power. I too, said Caleb, surveyed the problems and challenges before us. And I believe if God said the future belongs to us, we can march into our tomorrow with faith and confidence. I say, said Caleb, let us humble ourselves. Let us pray. Come on, somebody. Let us seek his face. Let us, come on, turn from our wicked ways, and God will enlarge our territory and give us the land God has prepared for us. If God said we can conquer, we can conquer. If God said we will win, we will win. Any battles we have to fight, God will deliver us. Well, Caleb had a man named Joshua by his side. And while the 10 spies saw the problems, 2 spies, Mr. President, saw the solutions. 10 spies saw the obstacles. 2 spies saw by faith a way around, come on somebody, a way around the obstacles. 10 spies were afraid of the size of the giants. 2 spies remembered the glory and power of God. 10 spies worried about what was impossible. 2 spies remembered that your God specializes in bringing down strongholds of impossibility. Elder Bird, God sent me by to tell you that for those 10 spies, their mindset and negative way of thinking was standing between their mission and their ministry. Come on, are you with me today? A grasshopper mindset stood between their faith and their future. A grasshopper mindset was standing between where they were and where God was leading them. Oh, church, their destiny was being sabotaged by their mindset. Woo! Now, what is a mindset? It's a settled way of thinking. A mindset is how you have constructed the world to make sense to you. A mindset is made up of outdated fears, archaic assumptions, you know, stuff we've been saying and doing for decades that no longer makes any sense. Mindset, it is the irrational, irrelevant stuff we have told ourselves for so long that even we now believe it. Mindset is made up of stuff we have said and believed so long that we prop up these falsehoods, don't allow the Spirit of God to challenge them. When the same mindset settles over a congregation or denomination, the psychologists call it groupthink. Woo! And the prevailing mantra of groupthink is, but we've always done it this way. Brothers and sisters, hear me. I've been preaching a long time. This is one of the most radical messages I've ever preached. One of our greatest challenges in ministry today is to clear the obstructions of mindset that stand between mission and successful ministry. And I know I can't speak to them all, but I'm going to ask you to pray for me. I'm going to address about 4 or 5 of them. And until we talk about mindset and deal with it, we can never progress. Now, the first mindset we got to confront is a post-COVID church attendance mindset. Somebody help me now. This mindset says we don't have to worry about showing up physically at church no more. Listen. You can bring me up, my brother on the microphone. Bring me up just a little bit. I want to back away from it. Did you know the most drastic decline in church attendance has occurred and is occurring amongst black people in America? More than any other demographic group since COVID, black people, and particularly young black people, are no longer attending church. Only 10% of the 18 to 30-year-old people are attending church. And just like the educational community is dealing with a COVID learning loss, I believe we have to face the fact that in our churches, among our young people, there has been a spiritual COVID learning loss. Our young people have fallen behind in their spiritual maturity. And if you don't believe the church is aging, I went to use a restroom in a church the other day, and I actually saw a sign that said, "Please don't flush your depends down the toilet." That is an aging church. Lord, help me. Since 2018, the church in North America has grown by one member per church per year. Our camp meetings, our salaries, our pastors, our evangelism, we only can get one person a year to join all of our churches in North America. Technology has changed the way we do church. You know, the five reasons people got up, got dressed, got behind the wheel of a car and drove to a building called a church. All of that has been digitized now. Fellowship has been digitized. You may not know it, but look at how your young people fellowship. Instruction is digitized. Praise and worship is digitized. And yeah, preaching is being digitized. Not long ago, I asked one pastor, if he were not the pastor of his own congregation, would he attend his own church every week? He said, absolutely not. I'd rather stay home. I'll send in my tithe virtually. Y'all are with me, aren't you? I'll worship in my pajamas. This mindset has become an obstacle between mission and ministry. The second issue contributing to our collective mindset. Oh, Lord, I'm going to step on Jesus. He's going to have to help me, Jesus. It is this. How do you win native-born Americans without alienating the immigrants who in many instances have become the financial and spiritual backbone of what is left of the church? Hear me today. Nobody wants to address this. The Caribbean, West Indies, they don't want to address it because they're doing good. They're getting more power in church. Come on, somebody. Native-borns, they don't want to address it because they don't want to be anti-immigrant. That's right. You got somebody listening to me. But listen to what I'm about to tell you. 10% of all black people in America are immigrants to America. And if 90% of your church or conference is made up of immigrants, that means that you are getting 90% of your members from 10% of the black people in America. And no matter how culturally comfortable you have become, listen, if you don't realize that if you don't fight to win native-born Americans in the church, that means you're going to lose your own children. Immigrants who are born in this country. Oh, Jesus, I ask you to pray for me now. You can't be willing to sacrifice your own children just so you can be culturally comfortable? Woo! I believe accepting this mindset is adopting a mindset that is standing in the way. As an immigrant, I'm an immigrant to this country myself. So that's why I can talk the way I'm talking. Lord, God help me. It's hard to win native-born Americans when the quizmaster at the crusade says, "Did you get question number 3 right?" Now, I believe we have to change the mindset of many immigrants who see interaction with native-born Americans as a cultural contest to prove their culture is superior to the culture of those who are born in this country. Church is not a contest of cultures. It's about building the kingdom. And we cannot have or sustain growth in this country while we can't reach and win 90% of the black people in this country. Lord, let me move on. Number 3. Another contributor to this collective mindset that is standing in the way of mission and what? Mission and what? Is that we have allowed our churches and our structures to become polarized and politicized. We need to depoliticize the administration of our churches. Do you know that you have a political system that does not allow you, the members, to choose its leaders? As a result, members don't get to consider all their leadership options before they make a choice of what leader is going to be leading them. You see, we have a political mindset and system that will only allow the members, you the members, and by the way, let me say this, if you continue to let it happen, it's your fault. You have a system that will only allow you, the members, to consider one name and one leader at a time that a committee allows you to see. And as a result, in most cases, all you end up with are a weak slate of Sauls. You never get to see your David. Even Samuel, let me see all your sons before choosing the one to lead Israel. He didn't say, "Bring me the name from the nominating committee." So if I need to break that down for somebody else, that's like if you tell a realtor, "I want you to help me buy a house." And the realtor says, "Great, but one problem. I can only show you one house at a time. And until you tell me you don't want that house, I'm not going to show you any other house." How long will you keep that realtor? Huh? Oh, okay, let me come down your street. I want to find a wonderful young lady to marry, but I'm only going to let you see one potential bride at a time. No, brother. I got to see everybody. I got to see all my choices. If we consider everyone, God may lead us to the man or woman of the hour. Okay. Another mindset. that is standing in the way between mission and ministry is how we use a military model to control the administration of pastors. Pastors are treated like soldiers and not spiritual servants who have value. Okay, y'all don't know, so let me explain. I've been a pastor for 45 years, right? Like soldiers, we only do what we're told we can do in this church. Come on if you're with me. We can only go where we're told we're allowed to go. The only dreams we are allowed are the dreams that have been given to us. Elder Byrd, I was with the top attorney of this church the other day. And you know what he told the pastors? He told the pastors, any songs you write, any books you write, any sermons you write belong to the church. I know, I'm telling you. That's a soldier mentality. You know, like one preacher told me, because, you know, you can't get up and go where and think, oh, the Lord just called me. I need to go and go talk to somebody. No. Listen, one old preacher told me, son, remember, it's not a call from God unless a committee votes it. That's your pastor. All pastors. Okay. I had a president tell me, if I pursued any ministry he did not control, I would not be allowed to pastor in his conference. And then I had another president tell me that there was no room in his administration for me. Those were his exact words. I have no room for you. For the last 30 years of my ministry, I have not received any voted committee calls. I have just been following the Lord. Wherever I have pastored, it's because I was attending as a member. And the members went to the conference and said, let's work something out. Oh, but God called me. He said, listen, son, start your own ministry. And so, Elder Byrd, I started the Dream Academy because I couldn't get a church. I started this ministry to children of prisoners and children falling behind in school. And now, this year, we celebrated 25 years. Thousands of young lives changed. And Elder Byrd, we've raised over $100 million doing this work. Lord have mercy. When you turn pastors into soldiers that you control, they go on autopilot, they lose their fire. They lose their creativity. You want to know why? Because good soldiers don't invent anything. Good soldiers don't invent new weapons. Good soldiers wait to get the weapons they are given with which to fight. So there goes creativity. And then you tell me what I create you on? Oh, now this is the tough one now. This is my last one between ministry and mission mindset. You ready for it? I call it the curse of doctrinal triumphalism. The curse of doctrinal triumphalism. What is it? I made up those words. God gave it to me. Doctrinal triumphalism. It is a phrase God gave me to describe the belief that just because you are right on the Sabbath and on the state of the dead, we think we are right on everything else. right on the Sabbath and the state of the dead does not make us right on everything else. That's doctrinal triumphalism. And it feeds an attitude that isolates us from the very people God has called us to reach. It also insulates us from the influence of the Holy Spirit and the working of the Holy Spirit. God can't help you if you think you're always right. Wait. Doctrinal triumphalism has given rise to a binary mindset. What do I mean by that? That's where you see the world as only us and them. So our view of the world, Elder Byrd, is 21 million of us and 8 billion of them. And we're right on everything. And by the way, unless you are becoming one of us, you're still one of them. I had somebody tell me they can't understand why I spend so much time with idol worshipers. And by the way, whoever came up, I'm coming down to close. Whoever came up with this term that we have all used, non-Adventist. Whoever came up with that did not do us any favors. Why? Because this verbiage builds two categories of people in the world. Adventist and non-Adventist. And I believe it is unchristlike and counterproductive to categorize God's children in that way. Now, I know it's going to be hard for some of you to stop using it, but you got to, come on, listen. I'm going to take a few more minutes now so you can hold on the organ for me. We got to stop labeling people bound for the kingdom as one of us or one of them. They are God's children too. And in God's eyes, they are no less than we are to him. My Bible says God is no respecter of persons, and only Christ will decide who is worthy. He alone decides who is worthy to dwell in the family of God. Oh, I got to quit. They told me I only have a few minutes. Yes, Jesus mingled with idol worshipers. And it's okay if you do too. Elder Byrd, I read where the servant of God says we should invite people not of our faith to camp meeting. I read that in the spirit of prophecy. Because if you're going to reach them, you're going to have to mingle. Oh, before I close. Oh, by the way, the servant to this church does not say that to be a Christian means to be a Sabbath keeper. Because you can be a Sabbath keeper and not be a Christian. What she says is to be a Christian means to be Christ-like. To be a Christian means to be a Christ-like disciple who keeps the commandments of God and the Sabbath. Oh, one more before I leave you. Lord Jesus. Yeah, one more. For hundreds of years, the organist can play now. For hundreds of years, the ability to read the Bible has been at the foundation of how we acquired knowledge and how we built character. Jesus built his character on what he studied and read. When the wise men found Jesus, the three wise men, he wasn't reading in the manger. Somebody took the time to teach Jesus how to read. And for hundreds of years, the ability to read has been tied to paper and the printed page. But we are living in an era and time of the death of paper. You tell people, no, I don't need the receipt anymore. But paper has been the foundation of how, or the platform from which people read. And now that there's no more paper, we are looking at the death of sustained reading and Bible engagement. Between the ages of 16 and 74, today in the United States of America, 54% of all Americans cannot read above the sixth grade. And 90% of all our Bible studies and Bibles are printed above the sixth grade. So that means most Americans cannot read a Bible. How do you expect them to join this reading intensive church? Mr. Great Controversy? So that means if we do not create, and by the way, that's what I've been doing for the last 3 years, and I just got a call from Microsoft. They want to see the work that I've done because I've created a platform for reading to continue, sustained reading to continue on mobile devices for young people in the digital age. What am I telling you? We cannot raise up a new generation of disciples if we don't provide a way for them to continue to read. And then lastly, what I want God to help us with. Jesus said, if my people who are called by my name shall do what? Humble themselves, do what? Pray. It's time for us to pray. If it sounds like I'm calling for a revolution, I am. We can't keep going the way we're going. It's not working. God said, now pray. You bow your heads with me. Brothers and sisters, this is no time for incremental change. God knows we need radical change in this church. We need what Ellen White called a revolution that is quiet and dignified, but a revolution nevertheless. And we need God to heal us of our mindset. We need a new vision. We need a new theological focus. We need a new way of choosing leaders. We need new methods of reaching people. But my God said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. I believe prayer will bring down strongholds. I believe prayer will conquer any loneliness. I believe in the power of prayer. I believe prayer will open closed doors. I've seen God do it for me. When you pray, shackles fall off. Yeah, I want you to bow your head and just pray. Prayer has the power to give you victory over every circumstance in your life. It'll give you victory over disappointment, over reversal, setback. Prayer will cast out fear. Prayer will renew your mind and harmonize your emotions. Prayer. And so as our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I want to know if there's anybody here today who want to join me in prayer for a revolution in this church. If you'd feel like that's what you want to say, Pastor, I want to join you in prayer for a revolution in this church. I want you to stand on your feet right now with me. Stand on your feet. Pastor, I want to join you in prayer. Oh, hallelujah. Do you mean it today? I stepped out in faith. I preach a sermon you've never heard. A dangerous message, some people think. A radical message. But as the old folks say, is there truth anyhow? I'm asking God. Ella Bird, I want you to come because I want you to pray. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. I want you to pray.
In Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to care.
Sing that again, everybody. What a friend we have in Jesus. Right on it, right there. Everybody, what a friend. Together.
What a friend we have in Jesus.
All our sins and griefs to bear.
All our sins and griefs to bear. Privilege it is to carry
everything
to God.
Some things we have not because we ask not.
Some things we have not because.
courage when
to the Lord in prayer.
Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Take it.
Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Your heads bowed, your eyes are closed. Father, we thank you. We praise you. Collectively, we've come down because we're saying we want a different mindset that we might engage in relevant ministry. So God, you're going to make some of us uncomfortable. That's including me. God, challenge me, challenge my mind that we might do a greater work for you. Now, Father, we've come collectively saying we want change in us collectively as a church body. We want to be relevant. Now, God, I pray and I'm asking now that you move by your spirit for the individual who's here today. The change is not just for them as a church member, but for somebody today, they need change internally. For somebody today, they need a different mindset. Today, somebody needs to move away from those sins that so easily beset them, God. And so today, someone needs to give their life to Jesus Christ. And so, Lord God, I'm going to pause in this prayer begging for forgiveness of sin. There is someone, oh God, right now who is in front, but they need to, like the woman with the issue of the blood, press through the crowd, come closer and meet me here and say, Dr. Bird, I'm giving you my hand, but I'm giving Jesus Christ my heart. I want to be baptized, or I want to be rebaptized, or I want to renew my commitment to the Lord Jesus. I need a different mindset. I need a different outlook on my personal life. I need to engage in ministry, and the greatest way I can engage in relevant ministry is, Lord, a changed life for me today, if that's you.